didn't buy a menorah for 80,000 shekel at the silver shop in the airport, I do not know, but he had apparently forgotten to do so, so he needed a gift for the president. So he asked Dr. Finkelstein, can I have a menorah from the Jewish Museum? Finkelstein told him that the menorahs were all bequests. I'm doing this from a college from Dr. Finkelstein's grandson, as well as others who are affiliated with the seminary. These were requests and they cannot be taken, but he said, but Dr. Finkelstein suggested that he had had a Torah that had been written for his grandson's bar mitzvah. And, as set out in Shoftim, Jewish kings are supposed to constantly read the Torah and learn from it. So why not give the American head of state this Torah? And that's exactly what he did. So they give this Torah, which had been written for Dr. Finkelstein's grandson's bar mitzvah, and then had been used by a chaplain during World War II, they gave him this Torah. Later, Dr. Finkelstein wanted his Torah back. Not for himself, but for the Jewish museums. That'll be nice for the collection. Beautiful. It's a presidential Torah. He put it on display on Fifth Avenue in the Jewish Museum. And so when he met Truman, I think this is someone who worked as president of the seminary, describes this. I'm taking the basic details from there. When he met Truman after the president's retirement, Dr. Finkelstein said to him something like, Mr. President, if you allow us to display the Torah in our museum, we'll have tens of thousands, or maybe even more, I don't know the precise number, that can visit this Torah. And Truman responded, well, I plan for the Torah to be displayed in my presidential library, where in Independence, Missouri, will be seen by hundreds of thousands of people a year. So that doesn't work. So then Dr. Finkelstein tried a different tack. And he said to him something like, you know, Mr. President, according to Jewish law, the Torah has to be rolled every so often to a different place. Meaning, he's implying that if you leave it in your library, that won't happen. So you should really give it to me so we can roll the Torah. And Truman points his finger at Dr. Finkelstein and says, Dr. Finkelstein, you are not getting it back. When Truman said about the Torah, I always wanted one of these, he meant it. And if you go to the website of the Truman Library, you will see pictures of a rabbi who used to come, because they would send a rabbi every so often to visit the Torah scroll, to roll the Torah. So it says in the captions of the picture of the Truman Library. And you can see Truman with the rabbi, each holding one of the Atzei Chaim, maybe together, scrolling the Torah. And there is a profound symbolism to this. We scroll through the Torah week after week, because we believe that each part, each passage is precious. Each story has significance. And throughout American history, different portions of the Hebrew Bible have served as pole stars to leaders and citizens of the United States. At times it is the tale of Yitzhak Mitzrayim that's back to America, as it did to the founders. At times it is the image of Jerusalem that will evoke emotion, as it did for Lincoln and for Seward. And at times it is Ezra and Koresh that will suddenly inspire, as it did for Truman. All this is for the good. As long as America, as Truman did in those pictures, continues to hold on to the Torah and allow it to help form its worldview. The question we face is whether the Hebrew Bible will continue to speak to America, or whether, as in suddenly secular Europe, it will amputate that aspect of its identity from itself. Meanwhile, if President Harry Truman adamantly kept the Torah that had been given to him, his administration, in its own way, gave the Torah back to the Jewish people. Upon the liberation of Europe, several rabbis and Jewish scholars asked the leaders of the American armed forces for help in publishing a copy of the Shas, of the Talmud, so that the Jews in DP camps could once again study the books that they loved so much. Now, one might have expected the army to refuse this request after all their job was to conquer Europe and secure the peace, not go into the Jewish book business. Yet, amazingly, the army agreed, believing apparently that the preservation of Jewish civilization against totalitarian forces of evil was an essential embodiment of the American way. So the army requisitioned the printing plant in Heidelberg, which during the war had printed Nazi propaganda, and in 1948, after 2 years, it published 500 sets of what is known today as the U.S. Army Talmud. And thus the Truman administration marks the only time in the history of the Jewish people that a national government published an edition of the Torah Shebaal Peh. I have a set of this Talmud given to me at the shul by my friend, who I think is here, Jay Pomerantz, and his wife, Udi. And This Talmud's preference features one of the most glorious paragraphs in American Jewish history, highlighting in its own way the extraordinary link between America and the Jews. Preface reads in part as follows. This edition of the Talmud is dedicated to the United States Army. The Army played a major role in the rescue of the Jewish people from total annihilation. This special edition of the Talmud, published in the very land where but a short time ago everything Jewish and of Jewish inspiration was anathema, will remain a symbol of the indestructibility of the Torah. The Torah is indeed eternal, indestructible, as is the people to whom the Torah was given, the people who proclaim the Torah's ideas to the world. And America is one country where the impact of the Torah unfolded in remarkable ways. The question facing us today is, will America cling to the Hebrew Bible as it once did, or will it become a country utterly unconnected to biblical ideas? The answer is still uncertain, and it falls to those of us who live in the United States to make the case for the Bible's importance to the American future. That is why we at the Strauss Center for Torah and Western Thought at Yeshiva University are proud, so proud, to celebrate a book that more than any other highlights what America once was. And standing here in the Israel, first recognized by Truman, in the Jerusalem for which Lincoln yearned, and in the Jewish Commonwealth of which John Adams dreamed, we hold this book out as a beacon for what America can be.